Good evening and welcome to the program. Tonight, we are going to be continuing our discussion on the younger generation, that is Millennials and Gen Zs. We're going to be looking at why Millennials and Gen Zs are decreasing in their attendance at church and why it is they feel that the church no longer speaks to them. So we've invited Alyssa Tocci, pastor at Antioch Church, to help us think through these issues and how the church can better meet the needs of these unique groups. Are you ready? Let's get into it. Alyssa, thank you so much for coming on the program. And just so that the audience knows what we are talking about here when we're referring to millennials and Gen Zs, I want to go through sort of the years that we mean by when we're talking about millennials. So for millennials, it's those that were born between 1981 to 1996, which would make them at the oldest end of the spectrum, 43 years old. And then at the youngest end, it's they're 28 years old. And then for the Gen Zs, we're talking the years between 1997 to 2012, which at the older end of that age bracket, they would be 27 right now. And then at the youngest end, it's 12. So it's a big range, different types of people, different generations. And so we're talking like middle school to, 43, having kids, et cetera, thinking about
almost middle age.
Exactly. So Alyssa, one of the things that we were going to talk about in our discussion today was sort of the incidence of millennials and Gen Zs not coming to church, et cetera. But in the research, I think we found that in actuality, particularly for millennials, there has been an increase in church attendance, sort of as a general rule, but there may be exceptions to that. And I think we're going to talk about some of the exceptions. But as a pastor, what are you seeing in particular with these generations, the Gen Z and the millennial? Is your church, do you have any type of programs, any type of activities, anything that you're trying to do to address the needs of these particular age groups?
Yeah. So we in our community, we do house churches, as you know, and so they're really tailor-made to the people that are showing up. And mm-hmm. the people that are showing up are Gen Z and millennials. Mm-hmm. We would love to have some boomers. Every once in a while, we have a neighbor come who is above the age of 45, but usually not. And our, I think, a few things that have come out in, some of the articles or research by Barna Group and different things like that, they identify why millennials are leaving the church, and they give some reasons for that. And one of them, where I think we address in our church, in our community, is the community. And mm-hmm. I know that might seem obvious, but when you go to a church of 500, 300, even 100 people, you can come in and sit in the back and hear a great message and raise a hallelujah and leave and really not talk to anybody, especially if you come after greeting time.
Right.
And so you can't hide in house church. Mm-hmm. And so millennials and Gen Z, I think there's a piece of attraction to that. I think there's an initial barrier to a small group. So if your church mm-hmm. is a small group, it's the same kind of idea of coming, of actually getting your foot in the door. Yeah. And so that has to happen through relationship, but once you're in, there's this huge need in the city of Boston for community. They say how high the statistics are of loneliness. Mm-hmm. And so I think small groups are so key to that for meeting that need of community. Another reason why I think small groups meet that need or meet kind of the challenge of leaving church or church attendance is it allows people to wrestle mm-hmm. through things. And again, in a traditional setting or in your normal Sunday morning, you're receiving a lot mm-hmm. often from the message, but there's not as much space for you to process through it, ask questions, respond to things that you maybe rub you the wrong way. Mm-hmm. And so in a small group, churches that have small groups in our city, we see this all the time where that's where people are really owning, wrestling through their faith. It makes me think of Jacob wrestling with God in Genesis 32. It's like there really is a depth of community and trust in a small group where you can ask the hard questions and you can be wrong and you can learn and you can know God in a deeper way that I think is more sustaining and hopefully will keep people in church communities.
Yeah. As you were talking, I was thinking about, this particular generation, and you have a house church, but mm-hmm. not every church yeah. is a house church, obviously. Correct. And so you have churches that are quite large in some instances. Yeah. And so what you're suggesting is small groups, even within those larger churches, are the way to address kind of that need for community. Now, take us back a little bit, because I know that I did a little bit of research and reading on this topic. And so one of the things that they talk about is the impact of COVID, yeah. right, on church attendance. Mm-hmm. And even as I was reading, too, there are churches who are, rather than, sort of doubling down on small groups, yeah. they're actually being more digital. And so yeah. you have churches that are primarily digital, and then they come together once a month. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they are actually being quite successful at yeah. doing that, at yeah. least from my reading and sort of anecdotally, they're mm-hmm. they're doing it pretty well. Yeah. So what are your thoughts, yeah. On that? Yeah. I'd love to hear, yeah. What you think about that whole trend.
Yeah, yeah. COVID obviously shattered the statistics for church attendance. Yeah. And we've, and like you said, we've seen a little bit of an increase since then, especially with millennials. But it's also really hard to track, because what is attendance is one of the questions, mm-hmm. and how often are people attending?
Right.
And because virtual is so accessible, yeah. For any kind of person from any mm-hmm. place yeah. can just click in from their vacation or working location or family mm-hmm. or things like that. And so it is really appealing still for people to maintain higher attendance in that way, for churches yeah. to get more visibility and get the word of God out there. But what that does is allows people to hide behind a screen, right? Yeah. I think that the virtual world of church is really significant, especially for Gen Z and millennials who we do a lot of our learning mm-hmm. on our screens. Yeah. I have a friend who calls TikTok, TikTok University, Instagram and Facebook, and just learning from people on there, right? Whether that's good or bad, and yeah. there's a lot of things you can find on there, I think there is a space for the church to be on there. I don't think it should be our priority, though, yeah. because I still think that what that does is perpetuates people's priorities being in the wrong place. And so what we're seeing in churches in Boston area, in my church network, but also in other churches as well, is among millennials and Gen Z, usually are at church once out of four times a month. Mm-hmm. Is very common. And they would say they are members and they're active and they're yeah. in small groups, but they're traveling yeah. or they're just would rather stay in their pajamas. Right. And so because of social media or the virtual church, it does mess with our priorities. And even, for millennials or people who have kids, I think during COVID and coming out of COVID, the need for community was met a lot by traveling with people or sports or like mm-hmm. events for your kids on Sundays, yeah. right. where that really wasn't, there was more of a no-no for that before COVID, yeah. right. but there was such a hunger for community. Now even families are at church less often. It's not as high of a priority anymore, I think, because there's soccer tournament and there's right. they found a lot of life. Their kids were isolated yeah. and now, and found this community that's been so significant since COVID. So it's not a bad thing, but I think it has got our priorities out of line. And yeah. so I yeah. think that's an unfortunate piece of the major accessibility of virtual church.
Yeah, as you were talking, one of the things that I remember, reading, of course, we all know that millennials are called the digital natives. And then, of course, the Gen Zs, which came after the millennials, are even sort of amped up to the nth degree.
Yeah.
And so they do a lot of things online. They are on their devices a lot. And so I feel as though, yeah. These churches that are primarily digital are also kind of feeding into yeah. a medium in which that particular generation already feels comfortable with.
Yeah.
But you're right. There's a this disconnect, right? That there's no community in the sense of like mm-hmm. actually seeing people on a weekly basis and meeting with them and wrestling, as you put it, yeah. you know, similar to Jacob with stuff. So one of the things that I was reading about more in the Gen Z side, and you know, I'll go back and forth this idea of like specific characteristics that define these particular generation. And so one of the things, and I want to make sure I get it right, so I'm going to read it from my notes here. It's this idea that for Gen Zs, morality is relative. They mm-hmm. have a lot, they really very strongly feel truth is relative, morality is relative. They believe are more sort of open to everyone, right? They're non-judgmental.
Yeah.
And so because they are less likely to believe in absolutes, similar to, right, scripture,
yeah.
which is absolute,
yeah.
The way to reach the particularly the Gen Zs, is to provide spaces
yeah.
where they can wrestle
yeah.
with those questions.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I'm glad you're sort yeah. of talking about that as part of sort of the strategy mm-hmm. to reach the millennial generation
yeah.
now and the Gen Zs. So talk to me a little bit about what you find. You say that in your church, primarily you have Millennials and Gen Zs mm-hmm. attending your church. So in addition to the community piece, is there anything else that you've noticed with this generation that's very different,
yeah.
let's say, from the Gen X, just my generation, and boomers?
Yeah. I think that I think one of the reasons why there are also millennials and Gen Zs not attending church is because they feel like they're not meeting with God, or they don't trust the pastors. Mm-hmm. They don't trust the people in charge.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of reasons for that. Mm-hmm. If you open up any kind of news media, yeah. you're gonna see things happening with humans, with people who yeah. have these giant, you know, roles and responsibilities and in spiritual authority. And so that is a major hurdle for Gen Z. As you mentioned, they do not want to be tricked. Mm-hmm. And they want to see and be 100% who they are and things yeah. like that. And so when things come out in the media about churches being differently than what they are supposed to be,
yeah.
That's a major turnoff. And so I think in a small group or a small community or a small church, having a value of transparency and vulnerability mm-hmm. to what's appropriate is really important. And as well as leadership approaching things as with more questions than mm-hmm. answers. Mm-hmm. And I think that also empowers anybody, but especially Gen Z and millennials, to really own their faith for themselves.
Yeah.
I think a lot of millennials and Gen Z have potentially grown up in a church or in a faith
yeah.
that they don't see translates into the world that they live in right now.
Yeah.
And there was potentially not room for wrestling and asking mm-hmm. questions, but more, this is what our faith is, and this is what it looks
yeah.
like. And now yeah. our world is even more broken and
yeah.
even more messy, and the yeah. church is even more messy. And so I think having spaces that allow, transparency and vulnerability, like
yeah.
I said, in healthy ways, I think is significant
yeah.
to kind of combat and allow people to process through church hurt, whether it was personal or just observed.
Yeah.
I think that the scheme of the enemy needs to be taken down in those ways where things can be brought to light, like, right, where there's light, no darkness
yeah.
can be. And I think in small groups or in smaller churches or smaller discipleship communities, whatever that looks like in churches, can be really significant for people's spiritual growth and maturity.
Yeah. So I think what I'm here, what I hear you saying in terms of the Gen Zs, and this may apply to sort of earlier generations, right? So when some of us came to church, we, not that there wasn't any wrestling, but that we accepted faith and belief,
yeah.
Right? We took it in and accepted it, right? Not necessarily without questioning, but yeah. this current generation yeah. really, as you say, wants to own yeah. their faith, which part of that means questioning yeah. and wrestling with issues
yeah.
that they have a lot of questions about,
yeah.
right? And so, you know, and one of the issues may be, you know, the whole LGBT, you know, Q plus, you know, movement and what the Bible says, right? The yeah. Orthodox beliefs, and there may be, you know, many other things that they're also questioning.
Yeah.
But I, this idea, let's dig in. I want to dig in a little bit more on this, on, you know, this particular generation and what churches who may be watching, maybe there's a pastor watching us, who is struggling with, you know, their young adults. And even maybe, cause we saw that as young as 12,
yeah.
just even younger, you know, struggling to reach this particular age group. What are some other things that you've seen that really work in addition yeah. to kind of the small groups, providing opportunities for them to wrestle with their faith, yeah. to really ask questions, for the pastors to provide a certain level of vulnerability? And why do you think perhaps that churches are not doing that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think one thing that I've seen in several churches in the city is real-time purpose and mission. Mm. And so not just coming to church or coming mm-hmm. to your small group with your other, you know, brothers and sisters in Christ, but also what does it look like to be the body of Christ in the places we're at? And yeah. so empowering people in our communities to be on mission where they're at. And so I've seen block parties that young adults in churches are hosting and yeah. serving their neighbors. I've seen a huge influx in churches serving at Miracle Mile ministries mm-hmm. and with displaced people, right? And just the way that they're able to just, be the incarnation, mm-hmm. be Jesus, yeah. and in the places they're at, in their workplace, where their faith is integrated in, mm-hmm. and have that be done in community. I think yeah. that's really key. What's hard about that is that's organic. You can't manufacture that. It's very hard, and I'm sure if you're a church leader, you know to say, this is the ministry we're gonna do. Everybody do it. So everybody sign up and serve. And there will be people who will do it out of obedience. Yeah. And there yeah. will be people who will do it because they feel the invitation from the Lord. But when the people in your community have yeah. a purpose and mission and they're driving something, they're leading the way, and it's happening more organically. So that's hard to structure and mm-hmm. facilitate and manage in churches. But I think that giving more attention to those things, encouraging and empowering the things that are kind of bubbling up mm-hmm. will give other people around them inspiration or courage to try yeah. something different and kind of demystify what it really means to love Jesus in all of your spaces and what kind of impact that can have, because it's major. And so having that purpose, so it's purpose mm-hmm. and mission, but the purpose yeah. of my faith isn't just about my faith. That's really mm-hmm. important and obviously the center, yeah. but it's actually about Jesus being known. Yeah. And what does that look like in my life, in my stage of life, in my workplace or my neighborhood? Yeah. And when people start to realize that, and they're doing it with their brothers mm-hmm. and sisters in Christ, not alone, I think that's a huge win. And we just see people come alive. And I think it's really helpful as to draw more people into the body, into the church, because they see real people who are messy
right.
and dealing with their own journey of faith, and they say, hey, come along with me. I don't yeah. have all the answers either, right? Yeah. It's not people that have all these seminary degrees, and it's right. it's all of us, normal people yeah. in our places where God has us, being Jesus. And so I think that I've seen that a ton, especially with millennials, like just being really outward focused and breaking down these walls of church and life and that integration, bringing focus and mission and purpose.
So. Yeah. So what you're talking about a little bit, I think, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is bringing in sort of social justice, because one of the things that I learned, particularly for the Gen Zs and the Millennials,
100%.
Is that they're really focused on sort of social issues, and that is a way for them to put their faith, you know, to actively pursue their faith in community, right? Because you do a lot of these things together with your brothers and sisters, as you just said. Any other ways in which you know, churches can serve this particular generation?
I think that they're doing it and they're already thinking about it.
Yeah.
And so I think the best thing that churches can do is get behind them and encourage it. Highlight it, encourage it, encourage people to bring someone with them. I think that they're doing it. Again, especially in the city of Boston, like there's so many amazing organizations in the city, and they don't have to be Christian. That's okay. Right. and even better, because then we're pollinating and we're getting in spaces where their light needs to be. And so I think that they're already doing it, and it's just about us kind of putting some encouragement, or just, you know, keep going, I think is what it looks like. Because like I said, especially Gen Z, they're in it. They're in it. They're getting their hands dirty. They're excited about it. And they're looking for, where's the church?
Yeah.
Where's everybody else? And so I think just kind of bridging that would have major impact.
Let's talk about millennials a little bit, just because they are at the old, you know, some of them are at the older end of the spectrums. Yes. And so we're talking about people who have families. They may have young kids.
Yeah.
And so how can the church serve millennials? I think when we were having a little bit of a conversation, we're talking specifically about families.
Yeah.
And how church nowadays might not necessarily be serving millennials with families in the way that they may want to be served. Yeah. So talk a little bit about that. Yeah. It's interesting.
I have done children's ministry for over 10 years, and COVID really shook, I think, this up for families, for millennial families especially. Families that have older children, I think, have a different experience, youth, and things like that. But millennials with younger children, where they could watch this sermon, hear the whole thing from their home while their kids were playing, not serving in a classroom once or twice a month with their kid, or standing in the back with a crying baby and having anxiety about shushing the baby. I have several friends who did not return to church after COVID, because they were like, why?
Yeah.
It's so hard to feel like you're not just inconveniencing or bothering people, and you're not even really able to engage or hear a lot of the time. Yeah. And so that, I think, is a real problem. And I think, you know, there's, you know, Hebrews 10 says, like, do not forsake the assembly being together, right? And so there's a place for us to say, hey, it's worth it. Even though it's really hard, it's worth it as millennials. And see the bigger picture of the patterns we're creating in our kids and what they're exposed to. And that is really significant. But on the other end, church is not structured for children. And to be there. And so I think that there's small things, like I've seen in churches, in a Catholic church, in the pew, there's a little card and it says, we love children. Mm. You know, children are going to be loud. They're going to squirm. It's okay. We bless them. And so that's really a message for, you know, Gen Z or millennials without kids, or boomers or the older generation, and saying, hey, this is, they're really important to us. Yeah. We know that you're going to be uncomfortable, but it's worth it for us and for them. And so there's small things that churches can do. I think it's important for children at the youngest age to feel very much a part of the church body, not just their kids' class, but the body. And so there's a variety of ways. I've been in a church before where they have this blessing that they do over the children that the pastor wrote, and everyone in the church knows it, and the kids know it, and they recite it, and they do this amazingly powerful blessing over their kids. And the kids are a part of the greeting team, or, right, there's just different ways where I think celebrating kids and families and maybe doing some things that are a little more complicated, but in the long haul, I think it's really important for children and families to feel like this is their home as well. I think a lot of millennials feel like this is not my home.
Yeah.
And we're coming here because it's important, but it doesn't necessarily feel like home.
Right.
And so that's really hard. And it's real. And so, but I think there are small things that churches can do to call millennials back.
So practically, what does that look like? Because I'm hearing you. So I'm trying to think, you know, at our church, we have a children's ministry. And so, you know, 10 o'clock by the time the sermon starts, that's when the kids go to their Bible studies lesson.
Yeah.
And then the parents pick them up after the service is over. Mm-hmm. But they're there for the worship time, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So talk to me, what would a children or a church that's really taking in the kids as an important part of everything that they do, what does that look like?
Yeah. I do want to affirm children's ministry programs.
Yeah.
I ran them for a long time. and I think that kids need both indirect and direct teaching, right? And so in a children's ministry program, it's developmentally tailored to different age groups and where they're at in their spiritual journey and their developmental journey. So I totally believe in that. I think it can look a few different ways. I think, you know, worship is a great way because kids love to sing and dance, right? One thing that we've started doing, and I've seen other churches do this, they send the songs that are going to be, done during the worship time in advance. And so children's ministry leaders can kind of tag that for families and say, hey, listen to the songs with your kids. So they come in and they feel familiar. We all like to feel familiar when we walk into a space, but especially children. And so I think encouraging them to do that, encouraging families to use their car ride or their walk to church to say, hey, like, what's it going to look like for you to worship today? Or who are you excited to see? Or I'm curious about what you're going to learn about Jesus today. And so just kind of engaging them in it together, both as parents and in church leadership. I've seen kids, hand out ribbons in worship, and so letting them own something that's really fun for them and bring adults into it is a fun thing. It doesn't have to be every week, because some people it might be a little much every week. And so I think there's different ways, children reading scripture from the front, if there's a piece of that, which is really fun for like a 7-8-year-old who's learning how to read and really powerful. I think the same way we involve adults, to be honest. I love this saying, there's no junior Holy Spirit. And so the same way we would want to involve adults in our service time, we can also involve kids. So
I like that idea about involving the kids. I know there are certain sort of seasons, right, that the children are involved in ministry, but I think you're suggesting a more frequency and in different
some kind
ways.
Of rhythm.
I like that. So.
Because if the kids want to come to church, then the millennial parents will want to come to church, right? It's a win. And then they're like, oh, yeah, I have friends who left church during COVID and then wasn't sure about coming back and then visited a church that the kids loved. And that became their church home. That was really important for them. And so even though it was hard to get back in for some millennials, their children feeling like it was home was worth it.
So
I think it's especially the same for, we're talking about Gen Z, some of those middle school and high school kids is really important as well.
Right. And I'm glad you touched upon it, because I wanted to, to talk about that younger generation. What are then some ways, or do we approach sort of the older Gen Zs the same way, as we're approaching the younger kids? Is that the same strategy for all of them?
This is not my expertise, but I was thinking about youth particularly. Late middle school, high school. And I have some friends who have had a really hard time, especially in Boston. There's not a ton of large churches. And so you could go to a church that's a pretty average size, and there's only one or two youth, teenagers. Yeah. And that's really hard because your peers are like the most important. And so youth group or youth community is really significant in churches. And so I know that there's some youth groups that are combined among multiple churches because of that, because there's a place and a space for them to come and have identity together and wrestle through things with your peers. But I also have heard, again, similar stories of youth being involved in the worship team, right? Being a part of the church. I think even more for youth because they're about to become adults. Yeah. Like, and so they're about to go to college or graduate, and then they have to choose what church looks like for them. And if they haven't been able to, they haven't felt home or felt engagement or ownership as a teenager, that's gonna feel inauthentic. Right. And so I think that similarly to kids is the involvement, especially along their what they're gifted in. You know, for younger kids, it's like, let's just throw them in so that they have fun. But for children and for teenagers where they're developing interests and passions and things, what a better place than to grow and learn and have leadership in that in the church. And so I think if it's music ministry, if it's tech and audio, and there's so many places, if it's, we've had, you know, like 13 or 14 year olds help with children's ministry, they're junior volunteers, like they love kids. And so I think even more helping them own being a part of the body of Christ, and also having some space to be a teenager with other teenagers who love Jesus.
Right. Yeah, one of the things I was thinking of, which is not something that we have here at Lion of Judah, is to, you know, for those that love drama, you know, have them take part in some sort of, you know, play or a little sketch that they can perform, you know, dealing with a story in the Bible or something, but just to get those the creative outlet for them and do it, you know, with other teenagers. So I was just kind of thinking about that.
That's so cool.
All right. So we've talked about the younger Gen Zs, the older Gen Zs. We've talked about the millennial generation. Any last thoughts on our conversation?
I think, you know, as we were talking and praying, I don't think that there's an issue with millennials or Gen Z thinking that the church is not, going to church is not biblical. I think that there's an understanding that this is what I'm supposed to do. I think what my prayer is that the barriers would come down. Yeah. And the barriers are internal, they're external, they're real, they're personal, they're all over the map. And so I think my invitation to anybody watching or anybody who's listening is to ask God to put you in a place that feels like home. And there are so many amazing churches, and we're all trying to figure out how to love Jesus better and create a community in that way. And so I think receiving grace and giving grace afresh would be my exhortation, is leading church is difficult. Yeah. And pastors and leaders are doing their best. And at the same time, living your life in this world, raising kids and figuring out what you're supposed to be doing is also really hard and messy and complicated. But the body of Christ is the place to do it. Not the building of the church, but the people of God. Yeah. And so I think that there's just a lot of hindrances there that again, are real, and my prayer is that there would be more small groups, more communities, more discipleship groups, or just like where brothers and sisters can come together and process through those things with the Lord through prayer, the power of the Holy Spirit, and see breakthrough, because in the body of Christ there is so much beauty.
Thank you so much, Alyssa. This has been a wonderful conversation. And if you're joining us tonight, I pray that you have learned something new. And if you are a pastor, Alyssa provided some great ideas about how to serve and to minister to this new generation. And if you are a millennial or a Gen Z, we encourage you to find that church, to find that space that feels, as Alyssa said, like home. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you next time.